My name is Kimmy Dahl, and I was the school bus driver on the 35W bridge collapse. On that day, we were at the Bunker Beach Water Park, and we were on our way back from there. We're driving back from the field trip, and that day I didn't know whether to take, there's two ways I could go back home. I could have taken 94 back to Hiawatha, or I could have done the 35W bridge to Hiawatha that way. But that day I chose to do a 35W because I assumed it would have been faster to get the kids home quicker. On the way back, we were halfway over the bridge, and Julie and I were talking about a boat that was coming through the lock and dam and all of a sudden it was like someone took a blanket and lifted it up and we were like free falling and I couldn't tell what was going on or what was happening, but all I did was remember to grab the steering wheel, hold on and hold the brake. And I could remember Julie asking me, "Kim, where are you taking us?" And the next thing you know, we were slammed down, and we went up again and we slammed down again, and there was like this big dust cloud, and all of a sudden the kids were screaming and hollering, and I couldn't tell what had happened. I didn't know what happened. And then you looked around and there was a truck right next to me, and it was just still. Everything was still and calm, and the kids were just like, I had one Jeremy come up and I had to tell him to go to the back, get the kids out the back, because the front door, where we were pinned up against a barrier of the road where they were doing the construction
And you had your own kids in the bus too?
Yep, I had two of my kids on the bus. I had my daughter and my son. And my son was behind me and my daughter was off to the right sitting with Julie
Did that kind of affect your frame of mind a little bit? Having not just, I mean, you're in charge of all these kids, but then also your own kids are on there as well.
Yep.
And you want to be a mom, but you want to be the bus driver too.
Yep. I felt that the kids all on the bus were like my own children because I have driven them for 5 years, and they all come up to me and talk to me. They all ask me if they had problems and stuff. But it was a little different having my own kids on the bus too. But I treated them all like they were family to me.
And so what happened when things started to get, Jeremy started evacuating? Kind of walk us through that, what happened in those minutes.
Jeremy started taking the kids off the bus and Julie, I looked down and Julie was in the doorway with her back to me in a tripod position. And I said, Julie, because I was holding the brake and the bus was still running when it landed. And I asked her to turn the bus off for me while I held the brake so that, you know, the kids wouldn't get asphyxiated with the smoke smell of the bus. And she was climbing up the stairs and she had shut the bus off and then she was crawling back. And then Jeremy came and got her and helped carry her off the bus. And then my two kids on the bus were crying and they didn't want to leave me. And all of a sudden Jimmy, another staff that was there, got on the bus and he said that we have to go. And I turned around and told them they need to get off the bus. I will get off as soon as I can, because I was pinned in my seatbelt. I couldn't move. But I was able to set the park brake and everything else because I lifted my leg up with my one hand and pushed it down. And then the kids finally left off the bus, which was, you know, I was comforted by that because I didn't want them to get hurt or anything happen to them, because the truck next to me was on fire and I could feel the heat from the truck on fire next to me. So.
And when everything came to a stop, were you thinking that more might happen, like you might fall further, or what was going through your head as far as that goes?
When we fell I didn't think we were going to move because I had my foot on the brake, but I didn't know where we were. I didn't know which part or which area we were. All I could see was that the bridge had fell, or not, I didn't even know the bridge fell. I could see that we were down on the pavement because I looked out my windows, and then I seen the truck next to me, and I was worried that the truck was going to explode next to me. So I made sure like the kids were getting off and my kids were getting off, because I didn't want nothing to happen to them, you know, and if something were to happen to me, it wouldn't have been them or none of the kids on the bus, you know, so.
Did you think that there was a chance you might not survive?
Yeah, because I couldn't get my seatbelt off for that. And I couldn't reach the seatbelt cutter or nothing, so I was kind of pinned in my seat. And then when Jimmy got back on the bus kind of did like a shift. I could feel like move a little bit. And then my seatbelt actually released, and I was able to push the button, get off, and I used Jimmy's back kind of like a support to get off the bus and that to help me off. And he had walked with me off the bus and got me off. And that, and then I got off, and we were up on West River Road, but we were up on the embankment because we were up on the bridge that we had to come down and go onto the West River Road by itself. And that, and I walked about 2-3 steps and I had collapsed because it felt like I fell from a swing. You know how when you fall off a swing, you knock the air out of yourself? That's what it was feeling like in my pain and that. So, and then the next thing you know, a guy from out of the blue came and stood by me and let me use his phone. And I had called my husband and said, you know, the bridge had fallen and I'm okay. The kids are okay. I don't know where I'm going because I didn't know what hospital or where I was going yet because I was still on the ground. And I told him I would call him when I could, you know. So, and he didn't even understand because it wasn't even on the news yet when I called him or that.
Did all of you guys, all people that were on the bus, get taken somewhere together, or did people get taken like little bits at a time?
Yep. Some of them went up to the Red Cross. When I was laying there, my first thought was, if there was anybody worse than I was, bleeding, any of that stuff, I wanted them to get taken first. I mean, I was all intact. I wasn't bleeding or that. I was in pain, but I wanted to make sure that if anybody was bleeding or worse off than I was, to take them wherever they needed to go. And when I left in my ambulance, I actually had another little girl from the bus. She was hyperventilating and that. She rode in the ambulance with me. And I kind of, you know, held her hand and comforted her in the ambulance ride back to the hospital. Because when it was like the blanket lifted us, it was almost like we didn't know where we were going. It was such a flash and so quick that we didn't know what was happening or what was going on. And all I could think of is that these kids are on my bus. The first reaction is just to hang on to the wheel and put my foot on the brake, you know, because wherever we were going to land, I wasn't going to let the bus move. Happening, and I didn't know what was going on or what was happening. It was just like this sudden wave that happened, you know. So, my first reaction was to just take care of everybody on the bus. You know, I needed to get everybody off the bus. I needed to make sure that everybody was safe. I mean, I was with the kids for 5 years, and they all, you know, they're like my kids, my family, you know. I watch them grow up, you know, and still today I watch them grow, you know, through social media and that, you know.
And how did this affect you?
It made me really think about life in general, you know, never to take life for granted. You know, you never know what your day is going to consist of or what could happen to you in a minute, you know, in a split second, what could happen and how it will affect your whole life in general, you know. Because I'm not able to work anymore and my body's shot and I'm young, you know. But you live every day to the fullest, the most you can. I have not went over the bridge at all. I get close to the area, but it makes me sick, nauseous. I get upset, you know. I feel like, you know, they didn't get a chance to make it over the bridge. Why should I get that chance, you know? And I have a lot of PTSD still. You know, train bridges, trains affect me, storms, kids screaming, you know. I live by a park, and sometimes I catch myself looking out the window like, why are these kids screaming, you know? So, well, now I get up in the morning and I am able to, I go to the gym and I do my pool therapy in the pool and that, and I do my walking, basically because it helps my body move for the day, takes away some of the joint pain and stuff like that, get my muscles and stuff moving. And then I've been taking care of my kids and watching them grow and pretty much just taking day by day, you know, going to my medical appointments and trying to make myself better, you know, one way or the other.
So the whole event is something that changed you forever and will always be a part of you?
Yep. It has changed me to the fact that I'm unable to work anymore. I'm unable to do a lot of things that I used to do when my kids were younger, because, you know, my kids were younger when this happened. I was unable to run and play with them. I was unable to do a lot of things, and now I'm able to, you know, ride with them, go shopping with them, do things with them and that. But I mean, it causes pain. It causes chronic pain and that. So a lot of times they sit with me and we hang out and do, you know, calming things, you know. And for many, many months, I'm like, why did I go that way, you know? And it was like the what ifs. What if I would have just went the other way, you know? It would have been better. Or what if I would have just, you know? I did for a long, long time. But, I mean, what do? You know? You can't make the decision in a split section, you know, section or second. So what do? You know? But, yeah, it was a what ifs forever. If I would have done the other direction, we wouldn't be in this situation. I'd still be working, you know? So,
anything, I mean, is there anything about the whole situation that you think people that weren't involved with it don't understand or anything?
Well,
like that?
I mean, people do need to understand that not all of us are better and not all of our lives are, you know, better. I mean, I live with chronic pain every day now. I mean, I have PTSD, things, triggers, I have all that stuff, you know, and I guarantee there's many of us that are not 100%, you know, and never will be 100%. You know, so people need to know that, you know, this was a tragic event. And it's nice to see that they're stepping up and fixing more of the bridges and the roads and that we deal, you know, drive every day and making them better and safer for us all, you know.